you see here was originally fitted in 1953, in the middle of the floor of the ship's binnacle and the gyro compass, which we used to navigate Britannia. The wooden one, closest to you, is the backup binnacle. Attached to each of them is a blue pipe with a chrome lid. These are the voice pipes which connect to the wheelhouse on the deck below. By speaking into these pipes, the officer of the watch would give orders on the direction of the ship to the team of three in the wheelhouse. The men in the wheelhouse would then operate the telegraph to instruct the engine room on the speed required. As well as the officer of the watch, who was in overall charge, there would normally be a lookout and a signalman stationed here when Britannia was at sea. Together, it was their job to ensure that everything went according to plan. But the man with the ultimate responsibility for Britannia and the safety of the Queen and crew was the Admiral, Britannia's captain. The only chair you see was for his use alone. In this high-pressured environment, everyone else was expected to be upstanding, always on the alert, for this was no place to relax. The room at the back is the chart house. This was where the navigating officer would plot Britannia's course for state visits, often more than a year in advance.
When you finish looking around the bridge, carry on.
The curved teak windbreak was a later feature, added for modesty's sake, to prevent sea breezes from lifting royal skirts. Beyond the raw bridge is the cable deck of the yacht, known as the forecastle. It was from here that the anchors and cables for mooring Britannia were operated. In the centre of the deck you can see two round capstans used to raise and lower the two anchors, which each weigh more than 3 tons. The white dome that you can see here is the aerial for modern satellite communications. Flags could also be flown to send messages to ships nearby, and you can still see the flag locker where the individual flags were stored. Toward the bow end, on the seaward side, you can see two large signal lights that were used to send messages in Morse code to passing ships. Looking out over the funnel deck, towards the stern of the ship, you can see the funnel itself. It has a specially designed gutter to stop raindrops splashing and staining the pale paintwork. Inside the funnel was a very basic multi-gym. Set into either side of the funnel, you can see the circular steam sirens. One of the last times these were sounded was when Britannia, on her final tour in 1997, sailed past John Brown Shipyard on the River Clyde, the yard which had so proudly built her. A number of coins which were placed there in 1953 as payment to the angels to guard the souls of the sailors. Atop each mast sits a decorative gold radio aerial. Commander, who was second in command to the Admiral. On the left is the Admiral's day cabin, where he worked, entertained, and ate. Whilst at service, Britannia was captained by 9 admirals and finally by a commodore. After a long, hard day in charge of a staff of some 19 officers and 220 yachtsmen, often working for 18 hours at a time, the Admiral could finally relax in here. The armchairs and sofa are over 100 years old and came from the previous royal yacht, Victoria and Arnold. The Admiral would have all his meals with them in the state dining room. And when there were no royal passengers, the Admiral would dine alone in this room, allowing his fellow officers the chance to unwind away from the boss.
Please move along the passage. The previous royal yacht, Victoria and Arnold would dine alone in this room, allowing his fellow officers
the chance to unwind away from the boss. After a long, hard day in charge of a staff of some 19 officers and 220 yachtsmen, garage to house the Phantom V Rolls-Royce, or occasionally the Royal Land Rover, was considered an absolute essential. But it was no straightforward task to get the vehicle on board. First, the car and its transporter had to be hoisted onto the special trackway that's fitted to the deck. Even then, it could only be squeezed into the garage by removing its bumpers. A suitable car could normally always be found in the country that the Queen was visiting, so the Rolls was rarely carried and the garage put to use as a beer store. Overhead you can see the pulleys or davits on which the Britannia's motorboats were stowed. In front of the ship on either side are two identical motorboats, known as jolly boats. And on the opposite side of the ship there are two fast motorboats which were used to escort the Royal Barge whenever the Queen was The client room was one of the Queen's favourite spaces on Britannia. It was a true family room and offered privacy from the rest of the ship. Here, Her Majesty liked to take breakfast and afternoon tea while enjoying the often spectacular views through the large picture windows. The Queen and the Duke of Edinburgh took a guiding hand at the design of the yacht, selecting furniture, fabrics and paintings. Today, their taste remains very much in evidence throughout the room. The bamboo furniture which you see in this room was bought by...
Tell us about on the deck. Maybe you see
off limits to the rest of the crew, these rooms were a sort of gentleman's club afloat. Would gather daily for meals and to unwind after a long stint on duty. This part of the room with its elegant dining table was where the officers ate their meals. Breakfast and lunch were more informal affairs, and the officers could come and go as they pleased, but dinner was altogether different. In the evening, the officers sporting the Red Sea rig, the traditional naval uniform at sea of a white shirt, black trousers, cummerbund and patent leather shoes, would gather in the anteroom next door for pre-dinner drinks. A number of the junior yachtsmen were naval stewards, and it was their job to serve the fine cuisine prepared by the wardroom galley chefs and the excellent wines brought up from Britannia's wine cellar. And for that touch of flair, the Royal Marines Band, when not on royal duty, would provide musical accompaniment to the meal. One for the yachtsmen and one for the Queen and royal household. When the royal family was on board, their food was always prepared by chefs from Buckingham Palace who were especially flown out to the ship. Before Britannia set sail, the ship's holds and storerooms were stocked high with fresh, frozen and dried provisions. Cold rooms could hold 2 months' supply of fish and meat, and the dairy and vegetable rooms held enough provisions to feed the whole ship for a month. Fresh bread was baked daily, and whenever possible, local vegetables bought to supplement supplies. These are still used to prepare the mouth-watering dishes that are served at corporate events held in Britannia, so don't be surprised if you can smell cooking. Carry on along the passage and you'll see on your left the Royal Cold Room, which used to be called the Jelly Room.
Next to the larder is the china and glass pantry where the Minton and Spode china for the royal dining room was kept. Every cup, saucer, bowl and salt cellar has its own specially designed compartment, hook or rack to hold it. The glassware, some of which dates back to the reign of Queen Victoria's son, Edward VII, is all engraved with the royal circles of Edwardian. With Britannia's exacting standard, every single item had to be polished daily. You're now in the largest and grandest room in the Royal Yacht Britannia, the State Dining Room. Here, the Queen and the Duke of Edinburgh entertain their guests in spectacular style. Through these doors have walked some of the world's most powerful figures to accept the ultimate honour, an invitation to dine at the table of Her Majesty the Queen. Sir Winston Churchill, Rajiv Gandhi, Nelson Mandela, Bill Clinton, Boris Yeltsin, Ronald Reagan, and Margaret Thatcher all have taken their place in history aboard this royal yacht. What made a banquet on board Britannia quite unlike anything else was the careful planning, the minutest attention to detail, and the impeccable style with which the whole affair was carried off. It took 3 hours to set the 56 places for a state banquet, when the position of every knife, fork, and spoon was meticulously measured with a ruler. The menus, which were printed in French long before Britannia set sail, were given to each guest to keep as a souvenir of a very special night. Then the large white panels at the end of the room would hinge back to reveal a film projector. Silver-grey carpet could also be rolled up to expose a wooden dance floor beneath, although the last time this was used was for Princess Anne's 21st birthday celebrations. Today, the state dining room is still used for exclusive corporate hospitality, and companies entertaining on board experience the same meticulous attention to detail and high standards.